welcome to our second VirusTotal Academy for SOC and IR video. In our previous video, we discussed how to avoid false positives, something particularly important when triaging samples. Today, we will focus on the other side of the coin, which is confirming malicious intent in the samples we analyze. Much like before, when asked to examine a suspicious sample, we need to confirm whether or not the sample looks suspicious enough to confirm it is malicious, and then send it over for further investigation. Let's begin.
Confirming maliciousness of an indicator is not always entirely possible, as we cannot determine intention. For example, remote control software might look suspicious for AVs. VirusTotal aggregates information from different security tools, and it is ultimately up to the user to make the final decision. In this video, we will discuss the tools we have to confirm suspicions of malice. The first relevant data point are AV results. Verdicts are not a sure way to establish maliciousness. AVs analyze samples statically in VT, which increases the chances of verdicts that might be considered as weak or generic. Additionally, some AVs echo each other as they use the same engines. In this example, the sample's AV verdict is related to a particular actor, confirmed by crowdsource rules too. The Community tab gives us external references to double-check. In other cases, AV verdicts alone might appear strong enough to make a decision. Please check very carefully for exceptions like this ACAR, which is just a test file used by the AV industry. Always apply common sense. Another important consideration is taking into account that AV verdicts can evolve significantly with time. A fresh rescan might provide clarity into the current AV detection. What to do when AV results are not clear? We have many other signals. One of the first ones to check are crowdsource rules. These rules are designed by the community to detect known families of actors. Rules work in a similar way to AV detections, with the advantage of highlighting suspicious behavior. The content in the Community tab might help decide maliciousness, although we want external references to double-check. In this example, the external reference confirms that the sample was used in a malicious campaign. VirusTotal uses different sandboxes to execute malware in a controlled environment. This is not always possible, like when malware implements advanced anti-sandboxing techniques, or when malware only reacts to certain conditions. With the exception of these scenarios, dynamic analysis provides details of all of the actions carried out by the malware. Sometimes this will be clear enough for the sandbox itself to provide a verdict, which tends to be quite generic. In many cases, malicious actions might be quickly identified, such as malware that attempts to inject itself into other processes, survive reboots, or manipulate system files. Traffic is also interesting, especially when communicating to an already known malicious infrastructure or when using unusual traffic protocols.
Dynamic analysis is a discipline in itself. But detecting common suspicious patterns will help us determine the maliciousness of certain samples. Additionally, during dynamic analysis, we can gain a better understanding of the infrastructure of a specific sample and if any other samples are related. For example, we can find that several suspicious samples with unclear verdicts execute a second sample, which we can say for certain is malicious, meaning it was a dropper. Let's see how we can get a quick picture of these relationships.
How a sample relates to any other indicators in VT is one of the best ways to confirm suspicions. Keep in mind it is common for malware samples to connect to legitimate domains during dynamic execution to check, for example, if they have internet connection. Communications with legitimate domains might also happen when malware leverages legitimate infrastructure to send or receive data. However, it is not common at all for any genuine sample to connect to a malicious infrastructure of any type. We want to get a quick overview of what VT knows about the sample in the Relationships tab. it is important to understand what these relationships mean. For instance, if the malware was found being distributed ITW through malicious infrastructure, it is definitely a bad sign. In this example, we can see the contacted domain is, at the same time, distributing many other similar samples. This could indicate that they're all part of the same. In general, anything we can learn about the distribution vector is valuable information. For instance, what if the sample we analyzed was dropped by a malicious sample? It does not necessarily mean our sample is malicious. Certain malicious samples drop legitimate ones for different reasons. However, if our sample drops anything that appears malicious, that is a bad sign. A typical example of this are first stagers, many times for PDFs, compressed or office documents that can be easily distributed by mail. When analyzing office documents, we want to check if they contain any macros. This is a very convenient method for attackers, but usually requires intervention from the victim to enable macro execution. Office documents are compressed files. Relationships help us get the malicious macro and even find additional documents using it, which helps unravel campaigns. Relationships help us understand causality in the analysis and help establish any infrastructure and other elements a campaign might have. This can also easily be seen with the help of the graph tool. For technically advanced samples, we might still need additional help. However, such cases are rare, and what we've learned will suffice in the vast majority of our analysis. Tools, verdicts, and crowdsource rules are constantly evolving. That's why we recommend monitoring these rare samples for a period of time to get clearer signals.